Mark Garman with VIB TV. We're here today with Bob Sampayan. Bob is running for Vallejo City Council.
Correct.
And Bob, you're a retired Vallejo police officer.
Yeah.
And so now you want to be on City Council.
Absolutely.
So tell me why you want to run.
There are a lot of reasons I wanted to run, Mark. And I think the first reason is that I have given a lot of years to this community as a police officer. In my last assignment, I was a sergeant. I supervised the Central Community Substation. I worked with the community, very closely with the community. And one of the things that I found was I was able to relate with the issues. We were able to come up with short and long-term solutions that to problems that we were seeing. And then now with my work with Fighting Back Partnership as the crime prevention coordinator, again, I'm out in the community, I'm talking to people, and I'm getting to know what the issues of this community are. And we've heard them all, we've talked about them all. But what I wanna do is I wanna move on and work with the community in the same capacity that I've done as a police officer. I wanna serve. And that to me is priority. This town now needs a city council that's going to be cohesive, that's going to be concerned about fiscal stability, that's going to be concerned about public safety, about our educational system, about redevelopment. And you have to have a cohesive council that's going to say, okay, we want to look at these and we're going to do something about them instead of being helter-skelter.
Right. So do you see the current council as having that helter-skelter aspect to it?
Not the entire council. Sometimes I see... You know, sometimes you see the council majority not coming together with the council minority. I mean, the prime example is the raise that the POA got.
Okay. Now, I mean, how do you feel about that as a retired police officer? I mean, you are someone who is, in a sense, part of the system.
Mm-hmm.
As a police officer, you put your years in. You have a good retirement and so on and so forth. Now, obviously, we're at a point now where the Vallejo police are some of the highest paid in the state.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess kind of the question is, in a sense, as a retired police officer, you must have allegiance on some level to your friends and associates that you still have in the police department. And as a council member, you're going to be facing in 2012 a very hard decision regarding the budget, which basically the budget that they talk about, the quote-unquote balanced budget, is predicated on pay cuts.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of that's going to be for safety. So tell me what your thoughts are and where you stand on that.
I stand for the residents of the city of Vallejo. That is my primary focus, are the residents. I wouldn't want to serve if I had special interests. My special interests are the residents. Those people who are here that pay their taxes, that expect quality service, that expect a town or a city government to do the things that are important to keep the city alive. That is who I claim my allegiance to.
You taken any endorsements from any of the public safety?
No.
Okay.
I have not been endorsed by any of the unions, by public safety, by Solano County Labor, by the Chamber of Commerce, or Board of Realtors, as a matter of fact.
Right, so you're not getting financial support from any of these entities?
No. And interestingly enough, if you look at the numbers and you take away how much some of the other candidates have received, you would see that my numbers would be up on top. And I'm receiving money from the residents. I'm receiving money from people that think now is time for a change. Now is the time that we do the right thing for this community.
Right. Now you've been working with some of the programs that are related to some of the efforts at Fighting Back and so on, dealing with prostitution, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Now, on the one hand, there are people out there and they're doing patrols, which you're part of with Fighting Back,
mm-hmm.
to work on creating a presence in the streets. Now, on the flip side of that, some people look at that and they say, you know, it takes that problem and it just moves it. It doesn't really solve anything. So what are your thoughts about the effectiveness of that? And are you, as someone in law enforcement, you're a law and order guy, in a sense?
For the most part, yes.
Okay. And some of the ideas surrounding law and order principles, so to speak, have changed over the years. So
correct.
Basically what I'm saying is they talk about things like the harm principle, where you look at a social problem like that, and it's a question of, you know, how much harm is it doing versus the potential manpower that's being put in. So do you think the approach that you guys are taking is the right one, and why?
Well, I believe that the approach that the community is taking is working. It has moved the prostitution away from the neighborhoods, and that was the primary concern. When we were worried, well, let me back up. When the neighborhoods started saying, we have hookers in our neighborhood, we have them doing their jobs here in front of our homes, we're finding condom wrappers, used condoms laying in the sidewalk, moms are walking their kids to school, and they are seeing these things, and they have to explain to their kids what they are, it's time that the community takes action. Obviously, the police department wasn't going to become overly involved because of the claim of not enough officers. So what has happened? The community got involved. The community formed their patrols, and they went out and started walking and moved the women. And more importantly, the Johns. Because when you have a group of folks that are dressed identically in the shirts that we were all wearing, the green shirts, with cameras and notebooks and pencils and paper, they're looking and going, oh, I don't know if I want to go over there.
Right.
That coupled with the cameras that the city has paid for, the city hasn't paid for all of them, but the cameras that we have, that has moved them away from the neighborhoods, which really has been positive for those neighborhoods. And that was part of the big issue. Let's get them out of the neighborhoods.
So you don't have any illusions about making it disappear.
Oh, absolutely not.
But you feel like if you can move it to where it's not causing a real a nuisance for certain neighborhoods or residential neighborhoods, that's a step in the right direction.
It is a step in the right direction, absolutely.
So Bob, on the law and order theme, following that, we have Measure C, medical marijuana. Are you in favor of that ordinance?
Yes, I am.
You are?
Absolutely in favor of it.
What do you think about this recent action on the federal level?
Well, we all knew when the state voters approved Prop 215 that there was going to be conflict.
Right, the Compassionate Use Act.
Right. Yeah. We knew there was going to be conflict because federal law says that the sales of is illegal.
Right.
And what I saw coming was that the feds would soon start cracking down on dispensaries. It started in San Diego probably close to 2 years ago, maybe even three now.
Right.
And what has happened is a lot of the dispensaries were coming into play into parts of the community that they shouldn't be. And if we want to talk specifically about Vallejo, the number I hear is anywhere from 17 upwards to 26.
Yeah, I hear 20 something is what I kind of.
So with that in mind, the concentration of them is very close in, and it seems to range from Curtola Parkway up to Tennessee, the waterfront over to Sonoma Boulevard. There are abundance of them in the downtown area.
Oh, yes.
And when we are at a point where we're trying to revitalize downtown, that image of the MMDs has brought about a negative impact. So what I'm in favor of is, yes, the taxation, but more importantly, the regulations that are going to bring about change or some governance.
Right. I mean, specifically, what kind of provisions would you like to see in an ordinance?
What I'd like to see is limiting the amount, limiting where they're going to be. I don't want to see them around schools. I don't want to see them in our downtown, obviously. I don't want them to be in residential neighborhoods. I would like to see a limitation in the number. So those four things to me are critical in developing the regulations for our MMDs. It's my understanding that there are going to be hopefully a limitation of maybe six, maybe seven, and that these MMDs are going to have to qualify to be able to draw on a lottery to be one of the MMDs that will be here in town.
Right, and of course you'd have to shut down a lot of the existing ones, a lot, or all of them, potentially.
Correct.
So, I mean, do you see that thing as being a big legal hurdle? I mean, I look at Stand the Man mm-hmm. Collective, and that took a long time, and something like
2 years,
over $1 million, yeah. I think, in legal fees. And it's kind of obvious that we cannot afford that as a city.
Oh, that's very true.
We don't have $27 million or yeah. something to, you know.
But what I see happening, though, yeah. the ones that are going to be closed, will be closed lawfully by the use of zoning.
Mm-hmm.
Also, it's my understanding, too, that we might not even have to deal with this, because I'm hearing that the police department is even taking a proactive look at some of these dispensaries that may not be fulfilling their obligations under Prop 215.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that's interesting just in itself. And if this federal crackdown starts taking effect, and it has this sweeping effect in Southern California, it could be advancing up here to where
right.
we are, and this might be a mood issue.
Right, right, right. So we'll just have to kind of wait and see what happens.
This is a wait and see. I know there are people who need their medicine. The voters approved it. However, did they envision anywhere from 17 to 20, 26?
Right. I think everyone, even the dispensary owners, agree they're just too many.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah. So you mentioned some of the things that the police department is looking at. Now, as someone who has an entire career in safety, what kind of changes would you like to see in the safety services in Vallejo? And let me elaborate on that a little bit. And you can tell me if you disagree with my characterization. But it seems to me that to a great extent, the police department got into a contract that gave some of the highest paid cops in the state raises. And the argument made by the council majority at the time was that we need to protect safety.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of citizens, a lot of concerned people got up and said, this is not going to protect safety. It's going to mean we're going to have very few highly paid cops. And that has come to pass.
Yes, it did.
So we've got a situation now where the fire department has given something.
Mm-hmm.
IBW has given quite a lot.
10%.
The police have taken raises. So what are your ideas to tackle the inequities and find a way for us to control the cost of public safety and make it affordable? I mean, obviously the flip side is we need to improve revenue, but that's part two. So part one, what would you do to deal with the expense, and how would you change things?
One of the things that we need to start looking at, and this is one, a nationwide issue, our retirement benefits.
Oh, yeah.
The pension benefits. That is, like I said, a nationwide issue. A lot of this is unsustainable.
Yes.
And the 3% at 50 formula that is being used.
Are you
now
on the 3% at 50,
yes,
Bob?
Yes, I did, but I didn't retire when I was 50. I
okay.
stayed on till I was 55.
55.
Yeah.
So
I was still able to work, so why not?
What do you think about touching of vested benefits? In other words, a retiree like yourself, your pension is protected by the California state constitution.
Mm-hmm.
However, the cities, since you brought up pensions, I mean, we're looking at a situation where in the coming years, we're going to see the general fund budget having to devote 30, 40, 50, 60, 70% or more
mm-hmm.
of the money to service retirees' pensions.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously that's problematic, because then cities are going to exist basically to serve...
Fulfill contracts.
Right, to fulfill contracts and to service the payments due retirees, and there's going to be nothing left for anything else. So what do you think about that? Do you think we can reform this in a way that's fair without touching vested benefits, and is that fair? Because obviously if you promise someone something for their whole career, it's really a shame to go back and touch it. But you, as a guy who's part of that retirement system, what are your thoughts?
Well, it's interesting that you ask that, because when I was approaching retirement, one of the things that I thought, because I had conflict with the benefits. I had mentioned it before at meetings, And even
specifically how so when you say conflict?
I've said that, wow, we're getting this great salary, we're getting all these great benefits. What happens if the city can't pay? And I was told by my brethren that, you know what, we have a contract. So that's bottom line.
Right.
And why are you siding with that? Well, others have thought that very same thought. It wasn't just me. There were other officers that thought the very same thing.
Right.
It was interesting that every now and then I run into one of them that will say, yeah, we went a little bit over the top. That being set aside, we need to look at pension reform. And a two-tier system, the way the fire department has gone, is a good start.
Right.
Now,
but it's going to take 20 years or something until people retire.
But then we also need to look at how much of a benefit are we going to give retirees now? Can we pay 100% of their medical? Is this affordable? Is this sustainable? And as we all know, it is not.
No.
And that is why they reduced the amount of the benefit to $300. Okay. All well and good. You were asking me about vested people. The ones that concern me are our older retirees.
Right.
Guys that retired, say, back in the 70s,
who are in their 80s now or something, and they didn't make the kind of salaries.
Correct.
Yeah.
And I want to explore a way that their medical benefits are completely covered, because they bring home, what, maybe $600-$700 a month?
Mm-hmm.
And if they have to pay for their medical benefits,
yeah, they're basically bust.
They're broke.
Right.
They are totally broke. And they deserve a quality of life the way the rest of us have.
Right.
And, you know, as our elders, we have to show them the respect that we've always shown to elders.
So would you support something? I mean, if just to throw something out there, say more recent retirees voluntarily giving up part of their retirement benefits to create a fund for the guys that retired 20, 30 years ago.
That is being talked about on the state level with the State Peace Officers Association, PORAC, that they want to develop some kind of a fund where the folks that retired back when would be able to have their medical funded. And I'm so in favor of that. I would be in favor of that for our guys. That, in matter of fact, I was talking to a retired officer just recently, and we were talking about this exact issue. And his comment was that he brought up at a retirees meeting, why don't we give back and fund the medical benefits for our older retirees?
Right.
And he was all but run out of the room.
Really?
Yeah.
Not too popular.
That
huh?
wasn't a popular idea. The city said they were going to do it.
Right.
And because of that, they're obligated.
Well, I mean, just speaking extemporaneously, I mean, it seems in a lot of cases that the officers and the police union in Vallejo, they quite frankly, they seem out of touch. They don't seem to get that the world really has changed profoundly from what it was, and that a lot of the promises that were made in a bubble, and
the bubble burst.
The bubble burst,
mm-hmm.
And we're in a very different world. I mean, it seems to be almost a cultural attitude. Maybe you could shed some light on that, because I've had the conversation with people from the police union, and I've talked with some of them, and I've said this a few years ago. I said, you know, there's going to be cops being laid off in California, and the answer I got was no, there'll always be a demand for law enforcement, and I said it's not possible, it's not sustainable, it's going to happen. Well, I don't really like being right, but I was right.
You are right, Mark, and I look, I pick up the State Association's magazine, and I look in the back of it, and it used to be, in the want ads, there were 10, 15 agencies that were hiring, big glossy full page ads, all the benefits.
Right.
Now, well, let's see, this latest one that came out, I saw two cities that were hiring. So that speaks volumes about what you just said.
Right.
The trend now is that if you can keep your job, stay where you are.
Right.
You don't want to leave your job. There's no such thing as going to greener pastures, because
well, we had some of the guys that left here come back.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
And that's a real positive thing.
Mm-hmm.
However, what distresses me is the culture that says, we have a contract, we have, and we deserve the best. We are not like any other agency. We are independent of any other agency statewide. And so our contract is our contract. Now, I look at what we used to do when it came to comparables. We don't do it anymore, so maybe this is history. But what we used to do was we compared the 14 cities in the Bay Area.
Right, right. That's been the...
And that was the norm.
The thing, yeah.
Sadly, that we compared with Sunnyvale, Palo Alto, Mountain View. We're talking Silicon Valley communities that have big money.
Right.
This is Vallejo. We've changed that to now there's, I believe it's only 7 communities,
mm-hmm.
and Oakland, Alameda, Hayward, San Leandro, but there's nothing down here.
I don't know if that's good or bad. I mean, it really, we recently on the website, on VIB, we did a comparison to FBI agents and looked at what they make on the federal pay scale versus the local police officers. And it just seems like, you know, in a sense, you hear the guys saying, we just want to be paid comparable to what other people are getting paid. But when you look at how the numbers are determined, it's kind of this small group. And to me, it says market fix.
What I would like to see, Mark, is comparables with the North Bay, not Central Bay, not South Bay,
right.
not West Bay, North Bay, Santa Rosa, Petaluma.
Maybe even some Central Valley would be more realistic.
Well, that and Solano County agencies. Because this is where the money's coming from.
Right.
We're not getting money from other places. It comes from Solano County. It comes from the city of Vallejo. And you have to have realistic figures, realistic expectations, and realistic forecasts if you want that budget to be true and correct. You can't say, okay, you know, I anticipate this amount of revenue. Because you know as well as I, the anticipated revenues sometimes will go flat.
Right.
And that's exactly what
well,
happens.
Speaking of that and where the money's coming from, another big ballot measure is Measure B.
Oh, absolutely.
The sales tax. And where do you stand on that one, Bob?
I am not in favor of Measure B. Initially, I looked at it, at first blush, it sounded like, wow, this sounds great. This really sounds great. Until you start reading the measure. And the first thing that popped into my mind is, wait a sec, I don't see any accountability here.
Right, right.
I don't see a spending
plan. It's a general tax.
I don't see a spending plan. I see money getting dumped right back into the general fund. And if we don't have a council majority that is going to do the right thing, what is going to happen? And this is the first thing that I thought. Okay, PD is probably going to get a 1.3. roughly retroactive.
Right.
It could even be more depending on how the negotiations go. Fire, who has given up, is going to me too. Camp, who hasn't had a raise since I believe 2004.
Although they didn't give up much.
No, they didn't give up much, is going to say me too. And the folks at IBEW who've given up
who've really given up a lot.
Phenomenal amount.
Right.
10% is just...
Well, the lowest paid workers giving up the most. It's completely
it was
backwards.
Wrong. So what's going to happen with that? I can see raises being given that are going to eat a lot of that anticipated 9.8. Now, if they try to hire officers on top of that, public safety, and they start building up the PD and the fire department again, or Corpyard folks, IBEW folks, and bring us back to where we were before bankruptcy, and this thing sunsets in 10 years, and we haven't developed a spending plan or accountability.
The bubble's gonna burst all over again.
You're exactly right.
Right.
What scares me is, what does this city traditionally do when we don't have enough money?
Yeah.
We cut services and we cut personnel.
Right.
So we'll be back in the same boat. Right. So after looking at that...
So you see it as a continuation of the same cycle.
And that's exactly the way I see it.
Now we look at the way the budget is written, and it basically counts on, you know, A, givebacks from labor, mm-hmm. and Measure B passing. So on the one hand, you oppose Measure B. On the flip side, what are you going to do to bring money into the city for economic development, for revenue, without Measure B? What are your ideas?
Right now, one of the things that we can do is work on our contracts. That's the first thing we can do.
So that's the expense side.
Exactly.
Right.
So let me continue with that, mm-hmm. because one of the things, and I know Mayor Davis has poo-pooed this. He has slammed Joanne Shively. He slammed us for using this, but I'm going to bring it out anyway, and that's looking at other communities and how they pay their public safety. How can communities in North County have more personnel and pay less? Well, it's obvious. It's very obvious. They're not paying the salaries that we're paying.
Right, right.
And that's one of the places we've got to be. Opposition's going to say, well, you know what? Our job is harder here in Vallejo. Well,
What do you think as a guy who's been on the job for how many years were you in the police?
Well, for here, I've been here over 20 years.
Over 20.
Total time about 30 years. But I've seen agencies up in the North County.
So what do you think? Does that argument that it's so much tougher in Vallejo hold water?
I'm uncomfortable by saying that is a solid argument. No, it's not a solid argument. Mm-hmm. Fairfield is getting their share.
They have
the
issues,
bad guys.
Yeah.
And they pay less than what we pay.
Right.
And they have more officers than we have. So how does that happen? How does that happen? And it drives me nuts to think that, why is this just indicative of Vallejo?
Right. I mean, when you look at, the example of where the police union puts out that it's much harder in Vallejo, and also what really seems, and you can tell me if you agree or not, to be a media campaign to emphasize how bad it is in Vallejo as a tactic in some sense to justify the salaries and to scare people. I mean, do you think, and that's my perception, that is something that's been going on. What's your take on that?
I would agree with you wholeheartedly. This town is not a bad town. We have our bouts of crime just like any other community. Granted, we do have violent crime, just like any other community.
Right.
However, Chief Nicolini said at a recent council meeting, that Part 1 crime has decreased.
Right.
And if that is the chief of police,
and it seems to me
that
like that is
publicly,
yeah.
What does that tell you?
Right.
Part 1 crime has decreased.
What is it defined Part 1?
Part 1: rape, robbery, homicide, arson. Theft over 500.
So all the badass things.
Yeah, all the bad stuff.
Yeah, the really bad ones have gone down.
But the point I'm making here, Mark, is that argument doesn't wash with me. I think a lot of people are using that as a scare tactic so that people will look at Vallejo in this negative light. And I want to kind of shift, if I could, for just a quick moment. That offends me because I'm proud of this community. I'm proud of the people that are here. I'm proud of what we stand for and what we can bring back. You see a lot of giving to this town. Look at the volunteerism. Look at the spirit.
Right.
Look at how people have come together during this adverse time and have come together to bring this into something that says, hey, we're proud of our community. And then you have your public safety saying, oh, this is so dangerous. And this is so bad. And look at what has happened. Nationally, we've been portrayed as this thug, prostitute-ridden community that laid off all its cops.
Right,
you know?
Right.
Wrong, wrong, wrong. I want to be able to celebrate our successes.
And we do have our problems.
Sure.
I mean,
there's no doubt.
No question.
No doubt. But I want to celebrate our successes, Mark. And I want to be able to challenge the negative, just like you and I are doing now.
Mm-hmm.
I'm challenging that. I'm saying, okay, yeah, we have problems, just like any other community.
And it's hard sometimes because we, like you say, sometimes it does seem overwhelming. We've got issues.
Mm-hmm.
But when I moved here in 99, I said Vallejo has got tremendous potential.
Mm-hmm.
And I still believe that. And I think it's, it's worth it to improve, not move.
Very good. Very good. I agree with that. I agree with that 100%. And I think that with the right city council, with the right people sitting up on that dais,
right,
it will start making that shift. This is not going to be an overnight process. And President Obama said it during his election, that it took a long time to break. It's going to take a while to fix.
Right.
And I have to agree with that.
Yeah.
We don't have that instant potload of money to fix everything there is that's broken.
No, obviously.
And we have
we don't have a potload to fix the potholes.
We don't even have that. I know.
So what about let's go to the development side. We've got people talking about things like a casino. There's the Solano 360 plan, which is probably some time off, but that's another thing on the horizon, as well as a lot of ideas get knocked around about what to do with the downtown, what to do with the waterfront. So share with me your vision.
My vision is that north end of Mirror Island is the starting point of all this. This is where it's going to happen. If that's done right, if our economic development director uses her RFQ process,
right,
and we get quality up at the north end, and we market it as such, mm-hmm, what I see over the years is that once the north end is developed and that starts taking off, it shifts.
So you really see Mare Island as the economic engine, if you will?
Yes, okay. Exactly. It will shift to our waterfront. Callahan da Silva, we're going to have to kind of step back away from that and say,
yeah,
pause.
Yeah, in a sense, you know, the whole thing with the waterfront is funny in that you look at this decision that the city made to terminate things with Triad, and yet we have Callahan da Silva, a developer for the waterfront, who has been there far longer,
yeah. Yeah.
And not done anything. Of course, it's in this economy.
It's a little tough.
It's hard to hold too much fault on the part of the developer for not moving forward now.
Well, their idea of development was residential.
Right.
And
that,
I'm suggesting...
That ship has sailed.
Yeah. That ship has sailed.
Yes, it has.
And what it needs to look at now are businesses that are water-oriented, maybe sports-oriented.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we have this magnificent waterfront that can be a real gem, not only from this side of the strait, but from the other side. So my vision is that once Mare Island, the North End, starts to market itself, starts to develop itself, you're going to see this move towards, okay, what will the waterfront do? And I see, again, water-oriented businesses. I see positive things. And I have to agree with our mayor that if we bring in a ferry terminal that is par above none, I mean, it is just gorgeous, where a person climbs off the ferry, has coffee, has shopping, has these little nuances that the ferry building
right,
in
so
San Francisco
has. So you're thinking along the lines of something that'll tie into the whole the quote-unquote transportation hub,
yes,
idea.
Yes, and ultimately it'll go into our downtown. Now again, is this an overnight thing? Absolutely not. This is not an overnight thing.
Long-term, sure.
This is long-term.
Sure.
But having a vision is so important, and to convince others of your vision is equally as important. And I believe that there are folks in this town that, well, and I know there are, folks in this town that I've talked to that agree with that vision, that if you start with Mare Island and you do the right thing, it will move on towards the waterfront,
right,
and then ultimately into our downtown, which in itself
now,
is
now there are some
beautiful
folks who are very much in favor and continue to talk about putting a casino on the north end of Mare Island. Do you think that's a good thing to put in that location?
Absolutely not. Mm-hmm. Absolutely not, and here's why. First of all, getting approval by the Indian tribes is a very lengthy process. The one that they wanted to put at Point Richmond, they started that 8 years ago. 8 years ago, and the tribes are still arguing whether or not they should have it. They just built a new casino over on, I believe it's Petaluma,
mm-hmm,
or Santa Rosa, in that area.
Right.
And if we put one here on Mare Island, is that going to take away from those going to Petaluma? You can bet on that. So That's one problem.
That it'll take
forever to get it built.
Right.
The biggest problem is you talk to any resident here on Mare Island and it destroys the ambiance of this island.
Mm-hmm.
It is going to attract crime. People say, oh no, it's not going to bring any crime. You talk to the police officers that are in San Pablo.
I had my truck stolen out of the parking lot of the San Pablo Casino.
No. Okay, there you are. There you are.
And when the cop came to take the report, I asked him how often it happens, and they have security guards there.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that it happens several times a week.
Oh,
he said,
gosh.
Yeah, we get a few of these a week.
So, okay.
Yeah.
I experienced it firsthand. Have experienced it firsthand.
Therefore, my father was visiting. He wanted to play the nickel slots, and it ended up costing me. I got the truck back, but between the impound, the tow, and everything, I was out about $800.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's not cheap. It's not cheap.
No.
So that's what I see happening here. You're going to have people, and unfortunately, the access is going to be, if crooks come in and want to do a robbery, or break into cars, oh my gosh, you just come into North Gate, you come across the causeway, and you leave that way.
Right.
So, I mean,
they could snorkel out.
Yeah. Well, they could do that too. But the bottom line is, no, that isn't right for Vallejo. For some people, it's easy money, but it's just not right for Vallejo. It's one of those, again, a negative impact thing that I think is just very inappropriate.
Right. Right. Okay. Okay. So, Bob, let me think about is there anything that you can think of? And I always ask this at some point that you want to talk about that I haven't brought up. Any area we haven't touched on?
I think the biggest thing not specifically. However, what I see happening with this election is so important. That this town is on the verge of the pendulum swinging back the other way in its favor.
Mm-hmm.
And this community realizes, and they really do, they realize that they have to do the right thing. When I talk to people out on the street, when I go walking in neighborhoods, when I go to meet and greets or fundraisers, I hear this echo of this election is pivotal for our community. Are we going to want 4 more years of the same thing? Are we going to want to pay out money when we were in bankruptcy? Are we going to want to go back into bankruptcy because we're not controlling our spending? So I'm hearing it time and time again. And the big thing is, what can you, Bob, do to make things happen? And a lot of times I get asked specifically about public safety, well, because of my background.
Right.
And yeah, you know what? Maybe I'll touch on that for just a quick moment.
Sure.
One of the things I see with public safety is we're not going to hire a potload of police officers anytime soon. If we do some reorganization where we allow, where we change the POA contract to allow the use of civilian employees for tasks like report taking, going to calls.
Right. So you favor bringing non-sworn employees
absolutely.
Into the PD.
Absolutely. Using our reserves to do our prisoner transport. Up to Fairfield. I mean, those are no-cost items, or at least the reserves. But what happens when you have civilian employees? You're paying them a lower salary, less
right.
benefits, and more importantly, you're getting those folks out there into the community to take reports, and you're freeing up your police officers to be proactive. Another advantage of that is that you don't have residents waiting. And waiting and waiting
right.
for a police
which
officer.
Which is a source
to show up.
Of endless frustration that you.
I
hear it too from people I just talked to.
I talked to a lady, who called me because she had waited over 2 days for a police officer to show up to take a burglary report of her home. They were told, don't touch anything because they're going to fingerprint. The officer didn't fingerprint. Believe us what had happened.
Mm.
They came 2 days later and she was livid
mm-hmm.
because she right. wanted to clean up her house. She wanted to make it livable for her and her family.
Right.
So sadly, things like that happen. The response time just, is phenomenal. With using civilian employees, we won't see that.
So people could come in that would be trained to take fingerprints, to look at the crime scene, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Right. You don't have to be a badge-wearing, gun-toting person to take a crime report, provided that it's a cold crime report.
Right.
Obviously, you want your uniforms for in-progress crimes. You want them available to take, you know, life-threatening calls. But your civilians can take the minor accidents, the petty thefts out of Kohl's, you know, things of that nature. That can be handled by a non-sworn person.
Right, right.
So those, you know, that is one thing that I would really like to see happen. Obviously, a council member cannot tell a department head this is what it should be.
Right, that's the city manager's job.
That's the city manager's job. And I think
you think you're prepared to navigate the bureaucracy of City Hall and deal with the restrictions of the Brown Act and everything like that effectively?
Yeah. You have to be. You have to be. You can't throw your paperwork in to run for public office and say, okay, now what? Yeah. No. Right. You have to have explored that initially before you even come to the table.
Right.
But you know, that's what I believe, Mark. Mm-hmm. That's where I'm coming from, and I truly, truly believe that our city is on its swing back, and I'm proud to think.
What do you think is our, just in summing up, what is our single greatest challenge, and what is our single greatest asset in Vallejo?
Our biggest challenge is fiscal stability. That is the biggie right now.
Right.
That's what got us into this mess. And if we don't do the right thing, we will be in it for quite some time. Our single biggest asset is our city, our residents, the people who have made this town a good place. I see it all the time from all my neighborhood watch meetings that I go to, talking to people on the street, going down to Farmers Market when we had Wednesday night celebration. Wow, phenomenal. Talking to the good people of this town that care, that believe, and that make a difference. That's what it's all about.
Well, Bob, why don't you give a little shout out to the folks and let them know why they should vote for you, Bob Sampayan, on Election Day.
I have a lot of years of experience with this community. I'm a resident here. I see what goes on day to day. I've talked to people in my former job as a police officer. I worked with this community on issues that were at times overwhelming, but we came up with solutions for those issues. And that was one of the most positive things I feel that I have been able to do in my career as a police officer. I followed through now working with Fighting Back Partnership, and look where we are in the crime prevention program. We have brought our community together. We're doing the right thing in neighborhood watch programs, crime prevention, and community unity. That is so important. I feel that because of who I am, the things that I believe in, the fiscal stability, working to better our public safety, working to better our schools, and working with our economic development director to attract positive business, that I have a plan that will move our community forward. Obviously, it's not going to happen overnight, but I believe that we can put ourselves in the right direction so that Vallejo will once again be the glorious, beautiful place that it always has been.
Well, Bob, thanks for sitting down with me.
Thank you, Mark. And, truly an honor.
Yeah, knocking some of the issues around, and we got a little, 33 days left, I think, until the election?
Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah. In fact, my wife is very happy that it's now.
It's a lot of work. It's a lot of work.
Yeah, running. It has been a little bit of work. But I have to admit that it's been, a challenge, but two, it's been exciting. We met a lot of new folks, and it is exciting. Thank you again, Mark Garman.
Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure.
I appreciate it, sir. Thank you. Cut!